as the United States moves closer to military intervention in Syria. New details are emerging that point to a surprising source for the weapons that were used in the recent chemical attack. Prince Bandar of Saudi Arabia. This is the GRTV feature interview with our special guest, Pepe Escobar. And I want to draw people's attention specifically to an article that was on Asia Times last month that I think was pretty prescient in that it predicted that the status quo would have to be changed pretty soon. And that was an article called War Against Iran, Iraq, and Syria. And this concentrates on something that I think is a much more reasonable idea for what this is really about other than a chemical weapons attack. And that is the pipelines. As we've talked about on this program before, a lot of this comes down to the pipeline politics that is increasingly hardwiring geopolitical relations onto the grand chessboard. And this is no exception, with a memorandum of understanding having recently been signed between Iran, Iraq, and Syria for a new gas pipeline that really could potentially change the game if it was allowed to proceed. Let's tell people about this pipeline and this memorandum of understanding that was just signed.
Okay, this is absolutely essential. It's the Iran-Iraq-Syria pipeline, which even some parts of the Middle East, they call it, with a little bit of sense of humor, in fact, the Islamic pipeline. Not exactly, right? But this is absolutely essential for two reasons. One, it bypasses two of the nations who are absolutely keen on regime change in Syria, Turkey and Qatar. The whole thing with Qatar, as we all know, changed completely for the past few weeks, in fact, for the past 2 months. Don't forget that until 2 months ago, Qatar was being hailed all over, not only in the Middle East, but even some parts of Europe and in D.C., as the next mini superpower. They were everywhere. Their foreign policy was everywhere. Their cash was everywhere. They were buying everything legally, like real estate in London and Paris, and illegally, like mercenaries all over the Middle East to fight in Syria. But then the emir is gone. He deposes himself, which is a story that is absolutely impossible to confirm with any official sources in Doha. But we can get around it. We can talk to people in Iraq. We can talk to people in the Emirates, traveling Saudis, you name it. And the picture is that essentially he was invited to depose himself because of Saudi pressure. This Saudi pressure was applied by Bandar Bush, Bandar bin Sultan, former ambassador in Washington, the couple of the old Kapi in the Afghan jihad in the 1980s, very close to the Bush family in the Carlyle group. We all know this story. So Bandar Bush was not dead. We saw that he had been dead for a year. We all remember that, since that attempt against him in July 2012. He resurfaced 1 year later, and his first photo 1 year later is shaking the hands of Vladimir Putin in Moscow. This is a story that I think a lot of people are already familiar with. The famous 4 hour and something meeting between Bandar and Putin, where essentially Bandar was trying to sell to Putin the idea that if you start opposing UN resolution, UN Security Council resolution, and he backed off in terms of supporting Assad, well, the Saudis would start buying, for starters, $15 billion in Russian weapons, with more contracts following. They would not interfere with, very important, pipelines, with Russian pipelines going to Europe, which means basically the North Stream and the South Stream, so which is ridiculous. And Putin already said that to Bandar straight away: look, we don't have a problem with that, unless you sabotage our pipelines, right? And obviously, after 4.5 hours, when he was not getting what he wanted, which was Putin's okay, Assad is toast, he said, and this is quoted verbatim from the leak. The leak was from a Russian diplomat. He went to an Arabic newspaper first, Al Safir in Lebanon. Then it was translated into English, and then it was circulating all over. It's a completely crazy story. But it makes portions of the dialogue make sense completely, considering the way Bandar articulates himself and Putin's responses as well. Bandar, in the end, to sum it all up, he said, look, there's going to be a problem for you with the Sochi Olympics. I'm going to release the jihadists that we control. He said blatantly, we control all these Chechens, and not only the Chechens who are in Syria or trafficking between Iraq and Syria, but the Chechens in the Caucasus itself. And Bandar says explicitly, we run all these people, just like he ran 98% of the Mujahideen in the 80s in Afghanistan. So on the other hand, they had an agreement on Egypt, because Putin is very much afraid of the Muslim Brotherhood, all over, supported by Qatar, obviously. So getting rid of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt was okay for Russia. But this Assad business, forget it. The pipeline business, completely stupid, because Russia is in control of all this. They have strategic partnership with Germany. They're building Nord Stream and the South Stream. There's no way the Saudis are going to interfere with that. And they don't even have gas to sell to Europe. Qatar has gas to sell to Europe. And that's the introduction for us to start talking about Iran-Iraq-Syria pipeline. So in the end, Bandar threatened Putin, saying, literally, there's only a military solution for Syria left. This is what we are watching now. So this is the Saudi part of the BBB axis, let's put it this way. Bandar, Bibi, and Barry Obama. It's the 3B axis, in fact. And this joke is, by the way, circulating all over the Middle East already, you know. So what happened with Qatar? So with Bandar pressing, especially the Obama administration, telling, look, Qatar, it's ridiculous. In a phone call, he actually said, Qatar is 300 people at the TV station, which is not very far from the truth. You know, I go to Qatar every year, and that's it. And the people that I talk to, that I get information from, are Egyptian documentary filmmakers, Somali guards. Never anybody from the government is going to ask me my questions. Never. Oh, answer my question. Never. So, anyway, Bandar impressed to the Bush, to the Obama administration, look, I am in charge now. King Abdullah told me that I have free hand in Syria. I'm the director of Saudi intelligence. I'm going to run this whole show, and I don't want these upstarts from Qatar. They have to be out. This explains why the Syrian National Council, or Council from above, all of the name that they have this week, with the guy that is in charge this week before he resigns. We don't even know who these people are anymore. These are out of the picture. So now it's Bandar running the show. This explains a lot of what's going on now, including the possibility of a false flag. Because Bandar is running not only, not Salafi jihadists, but Salafis or hardcore Wahhabis, but also Salafi jihadists as well, and even connecting with the Jabhat al-Nusra al-Qaeda in Iraq gangs as well. Considering that, last month in Baghdad, they dismantled a cell fabricating chemical weapons, in fact. This was the Iraqi Minister of Defense and the Iraqi Minister of Interior. They announced that over a month ago. So the way I see this false flag, they introduced some of these jihadis to a place in northeast of Damascus, already occupied by the Free Syrian Army and the collection of gangs and the opposition, since June, by the way. And that's where the rockets originated, probably DIY rockets. And this is what the UN inspectors should be evaluating now before, it's crazy. They're forced to leave this Saturday. So they had less than a week to conduct an extremely complicated investigation that the Russians, when they conducted their own investigation concerning a chemical weapons attack last March, it took them 3 months for the investigation, 1 month to organize the report, and then they went to the UN and they presented the report. You can easily find the link on the net with Vitaly Churkin, UN ambassador, Russian ambassador at the UN, his press conference about it. So, Qatar was completely marginalized, and Qatar's agenda from the beginning regarding Syria had everything to do with this pipeline. So imagine a pipeline originating in the south parts gas fields, largest gas field in the world shared by Iran and Qatar. So originating the Iranian part, then traversing Iraq, then traversing Syria, ending in the Eastern Mediterranean, probably near Latakia or Tartus or one of them, or a new naval terminal between both of them, probably with an extension to Lebanon as well. Customers, European Union, once again, shooting themselves at their feet, which is their number one sport. Same old story. I think we discussed already that, James. What I've been listening every time I go to Brussels for the past, I don't know, 10 years, 12 years, whatever. Ah, Gazprom, we are hostages of Gazprom. If only you could have a deal with the Iranians. They can't because of the U.S. sanctions. And obviously, they don't want to antagonize the U.S. This would be the perfect, situation for the European Union. They say they have an energy policy. They don't. For their energy policy to be coordinated with Iran, Iraq, and Syria, and get the gas from this pipeline, considering they're never going to get gas from Turkmenistan or from Azerbaijan. The problem is that the whole situation now changed because Qatar is out of the picture. We know the pipeline is not going to be built with a war situation. The same thing applies to the TAPI pipeline through Afghanistan for the past 15 years, right? And at the same time, with the Saudis controlling all this and threatening Putin at the same time, the whole thing is muddled. Because the Saudis, they don't have an alternative pipeline to propose to Europe because they don't have enough gas. Qatar has enough gas. So the Saudis and the Qataris now, they were more or less, there was a rapprochement for 2 years or so, and now they're completely divergent because their agendas are different. The Qataris support the Muslim Brotherhood, and the Saudis fear and despise the Muslim Brotherhood to death. So in Syria, the scenario for Bandar, ideally, would be Syria transformed into a sort of emirate, a Wahhabi predominantly emirate controlled by Sunnis with the Sunni business classes in Damascus allied with Riyadh, and would be a sort of dependency of Saudi Arabia, just like Egypt is nowadays. Now that King Abdullah in Riyadh is paying the bills, basically, of the new Egyptian government. So as you can see, the whole thing is completely muddled. But the Pakistan angle is still there.
For more on this story and other breaking news and current events, please go to globalresearch.ca. For more research and analysis by James Corbett, please go to corbettreport.com. The Center for Research on Globalization depends on your support. To purchase a book or DVD, or to make a donation, please visit globalresearch.ca today.